Thank you, Comrade Speaker. It's actually very easy to continue from this because many of the goals mentioned by Manuel have to be goals of the left group in the European Parliament are actually endorsed also by the new Finnish government, the left-green center government that actually our party, the Left Alliance, is participating. And I will tell a little bit about these goals. And also, it's worth mentioning that Finland is the chairman country of the European Union for the until the end of this year. So a few words about that also. So dear friends, comrades, and colleagues, first of all, thank you for this opportunity for having the floor in this important and topical issue. As mentioned, my name is Antero. I work as a city councillor in my home city of Vantaa, also a member of the regional council, and also a member of the committee of environment in our city council. So I have also kind of a grassroots or a local perspective on this global issue. So I'm going to have a few remarks on a couple of issues. First of all, as I briefly mentioned, there were general elections in my home country. Last April, Left Alliance gained a substantial victory in these elections together with the Social Democrats and Greens. As a result, there is now a new Red-Green centre government that consists of Social Democrats, Greens, Left Alliance, Agrarian Rooted Centre Party, and Swedish People's Party, defending the rights of the Swedish people minority in Finland. Left Alliance has two posts in this government. Our chairman, chairwoman of the party, Mrs. Lee Anderson, is now the Minister of Education, and former chair of the parliamentary group of the party is now Minister of Social and Healthcare. And the new government has stated in its program that it's going to advocate no less than the most ambitious climate policy in the world. I will have a few points on this. And why does this matter? I mentioned that Finland is the chairman country of the European Union, and the new Social Democratic Prime Minister Antero has said that one of the main goals, if not the main goal, of Finland's chairmanship is that the EU will become a global leader in fighting for climate change. Of course, at the same time, it must be done in a socially just way. Responsibility in climate change, as we know, is not divided equally between rich and poor, capitalists and workers, rich industrial north or developing south. Of course, it is the rich who have the biggest burden to carry. Of course, the most dramatic and far-reaching consequences of the climate change can be seen especially in the Arctic. Therefore, I think Arctic countries, such as Finland, who was the chairman of the Arctic Council for the last 2 years before giving the chair to the United States, have emphasized responsibility on tackling this issue. And finally, I will have a few words on the security impacts of the climate change and maybe the biggest taboo in this discussion, which is the huge carbon emissions of the armed forces of the world, especially the US military. I don't probably have to emphasize before this audience how serious the crisis we're dealing with. But still, I want to point out a couple of pieces of recent news which deliver an alarming message that the climate change is escalating rapidly. There are a few signs. First of all, the Arctic permafrost, the eternal ice, as it were, in northern parts of Canada is melting 70 years sooner than previously predicted. Unusually hot summers have destabilized the upper layers of giant subterranean ice blocks that have been frozen solid for millennia. Secondly, Greenland is losing its ice cover in a very rapid pace. The temperature this summer has been about 20 degrees in Greenland, which is record-breaking, and it has caused huge lakes to appear on top of the Arctic ice. Also, the Bering Sea between the United States and Russia, there's less ice than for almost 170 years. And also, Alaska in northern parts of the United States has witnessed record-breaking heat. And it could be that the whole Arctic is ice-free in summer already 2030. Thirdly, these before mentioned phenomena mean that most probably the current assessment of the rising of the sea level is too optimistic. current consensus of the IPCC, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, is that the sea level is going to rise from 35 to approximately 94 centimeters by the year 2100. Now a study by a group of experts predicts that it could be up to 65 to almost 240 centimeters by the year 2100. This would mean losing almost 1.8 million square kilometers of land and up to 190 million climate refugees. And fourthly, the climate change is escalating not only in quantity, but also in quality. It means that the Arctic, which used to be a global freezer, is turning into a global heater. Before and previously, the ice and snow reflected the heat away, but now lakes that have appeared from the melted ice are absorbing heat, thus speeding the climate change. And besides this, to addition to this, there are around 7,000 methane bubbles in Siberia just waiting to burst. And as we know, methane is much more dangerous than carbon dioxide. Also, fracking of natural gas by the United States has been said to produce around 40% of all global methane emissions. So scientists, at least from the Harvard University, are saying that there is more carbon in our atmosphere than in the last 12 million years. Now this can lead, of course, to nothing else but massive ecological, economic, social, political, security political, and geopolitical disaster. Dear friends and comrades, being deeply aware and concerned about the massive challenge of the climate change, Finnish left-center government has taken action. Actually, the program of the new government begins with the words climate change. Goal is that Finland will be carbon neutral by 2035 and carbon negative soon after that. It is worth mentioning that the new Danish government has set the same goal by year 2030. But I think this is just a healthy competition between countries. For example, we will end using black coal altogether by year 2029. State and municipalities will give up heating their premises with oil in year 2024. We're going to have an ecological tax reform beginning the year 2020. We're going to cut tax breaks and subsidies to energy intensive industry and implementing higher taxes on fossil fuels. This also means taxation of commercial flights. It will also mean new investments in bio and circular economy, clean technology, energy efficiency, emission-free energy, ecological forestry, agriculture, housing, city planning, and traffic. These are all common goals that our colleague mentioned that are also goals on the left in the European level. So I think that these aims kind of meet. But as said earlier, this has to be done in a socially fair way. Normal working class and middle class people with low income, for example, pensioners, need to afford climate action. And our government says that the impacts of the higher taxation on fossil fuels, for example, will be taken into account in income taxation and social security of people of lower income. It is the rich who need to carry most of the burden. Dear friends and colleagues, I think that my country can set an example because it is the chairman of the European Union. And as I mentioned, EU should become a global leader in struggle against climate change. We have set the goal that EU would be carbon neutral by 2050. This is also the official goal of the EU. But our estimation is that the carbon emissions must be cut by 55% by year 2030 compared to 1990. And although the current framework by the EU Commission in its Clean Planet for All plan is 45%. So our aim is 55, the official EU position is 45, and we consider the EU official EU position is not enough. There are also many concrete tools that could be mentioned, but I won't bother you with all these EU-Europe bureaucratic buzzwords, you can read them from online in EU2019.fi. Everything is found in English, in French, and German. The official goals. I would just like to point out that there are some issues that are probably not mentioned in the official program, but this means also reducing emission allowances and possibly special customs on carbon emissions on import from countries outside the EU. Also, Finland thinks that sanctions against Russia should be not applied when we talk about financing environmental cooperation between Russia and EU countries. And as we know, almost everyone in Europe is more or less in favor of climate action, at least in words, and with lots of conditions. And this is called yes but politics. And I think this is it's about time to abandon this yes but politics. Few words still about the role of the local governments and security impacts. As we know, EU and EU countries have still a lot to do. But the biggest political problems are not in Europe. The single greatest, I would say, adversary of the climate is the administration of President Donald Trump and the whole current Republican regime of the United States. At the same time, we must remember that federal government in the US is not the only actor. There are 10 states, almost 300 major cities, and more than 2,000 businesses who have committed themselves to support climate action. They form so-called We're Still In Coalition. It also includes religious communities, universities, and cultural institutions. And this should be, I think, noted also in Europe, where cities are becoming more and more important political and economic actors alongside states. I work as a city councilor, and we have, in my home city, we have, for example, adopted very strict goals on saving natural and energy resources, circular economy, and cutting carbon emissions. And for example, all non-recyclable household waste is burned to produce electricity and heat. And the aim of the city is to become carbon neutral already by the year 2030. And by the way, this goal has been accepted with the consensus of all political parties, including otherwise climate change denying friends, ours, right-wing populists. So what I would like to underline is that what we need is climate action on local and regional level. Many of the parties that are gathered here do not maybe have government positions on national level or even in national parliaments. But what we all have is influence on local level, in city and regional councils or other legislative bodies on the local level. And I think we should use this power of influence for climate action. My timer says 13 minutes, so I suppose I'll have a couple of more minutes. Thank you. I would like to point out still one thing, is that climate change is not only a question about natural environment, agriculture, ecology, or economy. Climate change can have deep-rooted consequences on security, global security policy, and downright to traditional geopolitics. One well-known example is the civil war in Syria. Although this conclusion is disputed, one can argue that extreme drought caused by global warming was one of the key factors why the violent conflict broke out. Price of food went up, and because of the drought, many of the farmers and people living in small rural communities lost their livelihood. This led to protests which were suppressed by force. And this led to escalation of violence and burst into a full-scale civil war, which we have witnessed until today. And this civil war in Syria is potentially the most dangerous military conflict of our time. Both Russia and the United States are heavily involved in military operations in the area. And there is a risk for collision course these two military powers. So what I'm trying to say, there is a chain from climate change to war, to geopolitics and collision of superpowers on a military level. Also, a study published at the end of 2017 predicts that the future of climate change can lead up to 1 million refugees. That this would have catastrophic consequences for countries sending and countries receiving refugees. Now this is actually quite funny why our friends in the far right, friends in quotes, hope you understand in an ironic sense, why so many right, far right populists are very reluctant to take any climate action. Probably, especially they should be actively promoting struggle against climate change. Because if not, European countries are going to have a huge influx of new refugees. 2015 was nothing compared to that. And finally, I would just like to point out one thing that is totally being left out of the discussion of climate change. It is the huge emissions of the armed forces in the world. United States armed forces is the biggest single consumer of fossil fuels in the world. Its carbon emissions are bigger than emissions of the whole country of Portugal. Emissions are caused by its war machinery, tanks, planes, ships, but also the war itself and global network of military bases, which is bigger than any other country in the world. And at the same time, Pentagon itself already admits that the climate change is a significant threat to the national security of the United States. One can only say, oh, the irony. But friends and comrades, in conclusion, and this is the very last sentence, if we want to win climate change within the next few decades, it all comes down to political will. And as we know, fortunately, political will is a renewable resource. Thank you.
We're going to take a 10-minute break so that we don't leave your seats, but so that the translators can have a little break. And we will resume with Ali speaking. You're from Fridays for Future. Thank you. Just a few minutes for the